கால்நடை பராமரிப்பு அமைச்சர் திரு உடுமலை ராதாகிருஷ்ணன் அவர்களே, பிஎஸ்ஜி மற்றும் சன்ஸ் அறக்கட்டளையினோட தலைவர் ஸ்ரீ ஜி ஆர் கார்த்திகேயன் அவர்களே, பிஎஸ்ஜி மற்றும் சன்ஸ் அறக்கட்டளையின் நிர்வாக அறங்காவலர் ஸ்ரீ எல் கோபாலகிருஷ்ணன் அவர்களே, முதல்வர் டாக்டர் விருந்தா அவர்களே, அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். பிஎஸ்ஜி கலை மற்றும் அறிவியல் கல்வி நிறுவனத்தின் மாணவர்களுடன் இங்கு வந்து உரையாடினால் நான் மிகுந்த மகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். பிஎஸ்சி மற்றும் சயின்ஸ் அறக்கட்டளை மேற்கொண்ட தொண்டு மற்றும் தர்ம செயல்கள் மிகவும் பாராட்டத்தக்கவை. சர்வதேய தாய்மொழி தினாத்திற்கு எனது வாழ்த்துக்களை தோறிவித்துக்கு கூறுகிறேன். ஐ ஃபீல் வெரி ப்ரவுட் to meet and greet students and the youth across the country. After I became vice president, I have decided I should visit as many education institutions as possible and then interact with the students and also research institutes, management institutes, agricultural science, technology related institutes, know what is happening, what is being done, tell them what need to be done, and also feel satisfied about the progress that is being made in various educational, technological, scientific research, and more particularly agriculture related institutes. And I particularly feel happy whenever I come to Coimbatore, because Coimbatore is
not only a beautiful city but also consists of beautiful people and citizens. That's why I like this city. City is not only beautiful but people also are beautiful. And the third is I am extremely happy to visit PSG institutions, because these founders of these institutions, the great people, they have set an example keeping the traditions of India. What is the tradition of India is share and care. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. That's what our forefathers has given to us. Anybody continuing the tradition, I always feel happy and always want to go meet them and also encourage them. I have gone through the story of these great people. Earlier I had the occasion to visit some of your institutions and I was greatly impressed by the life and the service that was being rendered now, and also the progress that is being made by these great PSG institutions. That's why I am very happy to be here and meeting you all students. This time it is Arts and Science Colleges. I am told some engineering students also are there. I compliment the PSG and Sons Charities Trust for providing education for lakhs of students, mostly from the weaker sections, through their educational institutions over the years. PSG founder, P.S. Govindaraj Naidu, has shown his concern for the underprivileged through his charitable deeds, not by mere words. While he has three sons, he divided his properties into four parts so that the activities of the trust could be run by the apportioned portion. What a great example he has set it. I really salute the memory of these great people, because we have set this model of sharing and caring, some of their property being set, wealth being set apart for creating social service and charitable activities. I am of the opinion that every Indian, whoever is little affluent, whoever is capable, must follow this example and set part of their income or earnings or their prosperity or property for the sake of the society, because we Indians, as I told you in the beginning, that we believe in the principle of Vasudhaika Kutumbakam, The entire universe is one family. And one entire universe is one family, and entire India must be one family. And entire Tamil Nadu must be one family. That concept has to be protected, nourished, and propagated, and practiced also. The happy to know that around 48 full-time and part-time programs in science, engineering, and management are being offered at the undergraduate and postgraduate levels by the 11 engineering and technology, computer applications, management sciences, basic sciences, and humanities department. I'm happy to learn that more than 505 research scholars are pursuing research programs for PhD, MS, MTech degrees. My dear staff members, my dear youngsters, education or learning should be a continuous process. Education is not only for employment, education is for enhancement of knowledge. Education is for enlightenment. Education is for empowerment also. And finally, education for employment also. But we are giving more importance to employment. First of all, you must be empowered with knowledge so that you can lead a successful and happy life. That's my conviction. Kedil Vilachalvam Kalu Varukku Madala Matrayave, the great poet Tirukural said, education or learning should be a continuous process. Education must be lifelong. That's why I feel that everybody should continue to learn. Before you start to learn, and continue to learn also. Some of you may be interested to go abroad also. Lot of people have gone from India and even from Coimbatore. Earlier I used to advise children, why are you going abroad? There's a lot of opportunities are here. Opportunities are, no doubt they are here, but there's no problem. If you want to go, you can go also. We have enough population to take care. But go, learn, earn, and return. Come back to serve your motherland, serve your neighbors. That is my advice to all the youngsters. And as I was telling, everybody in life, including teachers, including doctors, including actors, including tractor running farmers, including politicians, everybody must upgrade their skill, because life is changing, world is changing. We are living in an era of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. Everything is open now, competition is there. And now we are allowing 100% foreign direct investment also. So that gives us a lot of opportunities, but also throws many challenges. So our education, our knowledge upgradation, our skill upgradation must train our younger generation to face the challenges. This is a very important thing in the present situation where the universe is open and it's become a global village. Learning is a true imperishable riches. All other things are not riches. You have to understand this. Education is central to development and improvement of the lives of the people. Education develops the humanity, human personality in all its dimensions, intellectual, physical, social, cultural, moral and spiritual. Education should not be limited or restricted to the classroom experience. Efforts must be made to make it holistic learning experience. That's why I was suggesting to all the education institutions, half of the time in the classroom, remaining time in the work field or play field. That should be the future, because simply sitting in classroom alone is not going to teach you the life skills. It requires field visits. It requires interaction with the people. It requires interaction with the farmers, particularly agriculturists, because agriculture is the basic culture of India. So all our education institutions must also provide this opportunity, and also must promote schools, colleges must promote us not only skills. Skill upgradation is very much required to face the new challenges and take advantage of the new opportunities. That's why I say schooling and skilling must go together. Schooling and skilling must go together. And then we must also, if you want to scale to further heights, you must be physically fit. If you are physically fit, then you will be mentally alert. So that's why the Prime Minister has given a call for Fitness India. Everybody must do something or other for physical activity, not for others, for your sake, for your own future. This is very much important. Whether you follow yoga, or you do running, or skating, or swimming, or any other thing, farming, anything, do some physical activity because of the modern changes that are happening, the lifestyle changes. We are following, some of the children are following sedentary lifestyle, which is no good at all. It will make you lazy and later you will become crazy. This has to be understood. So for that, physical fitness is very important. Yoga, of course, Modi ji has proposed it in the United Nations, and I am happy more than 170 plus countries are observing yoga throughout the world. We are very happy because yoga is an ancient art and science. It is both science and art. It brings unity of body and mind, and also it provides you space for spiritual happiness. So please take part in yoga also. This is my advice to all the youngsters. And yoga is not connected with politics or not with the governance. Yoga is for your body, not for Modi. You have to understand this. Modi ji, yes, of course, as a Prime Minister, he promoted it. But we, people of India, we must go back to our ancient art. I am 70 plus now, my dear youngsters, 71 to be precise. I play badminton every day morning 1 hour and walk half an hour, talk for hours, and also do little yoga. I am not doing any service to the society. This is for my body and my fitness. You must live long, but you must live healthy. See, simply living long life without health is a curse. And health, if you acquire health, you can acquire wealth. But it's not vice versa. If you are wealthy, if you are not healthy, you can't eat any good food. Coimbatore is known for good food. So, healthy life is also an important aspect in our life. Second, also food habits. The latest international magazines are saying the non-communicable diseases are increasing day by day because of two reasons. One is the sedentary lifestyle. Second is eating the junk food. We must avoid the junk food, not be tempted by this propaganda, branding and all. You see all a lot of advertisements and some of our children falling prey to that pizza, burger, junk food, not going to add anything, no value. Secondly, children say, sir, now it's instant food. There cannot be anything instant. Instant food means constant disease. I am saying it everywhere to warn our youngsters, please be healthy, eat healthy food, and then promote healthy food, eat proteinous food. Simply eating food alone is not sufficient. You need to eat proteinous food. This has to be kept in mind. Our approach to education also includes the spiritual aspect of the development and does not restrict itself to individual or material achievements. Indian culture and its traditions based on Vedas and Upanishads described education as a tool to realize true knowledge and a way to understand the absolute. Given the importance of education in one's life, it has been accorded the highest priority in our Indian tradition and culture. Guru, the teacher, was given the status of God, next to God. India's education system followed the concept of Gurukula, where great attention was paid to development of the child's character. Teachers or gurus laid stress and emphasis on the integral development of an individual's personality. The Gurukula system of education promoted disciplined life, instilled morals, ethics and values of Indian civilization. Teachers used to tell the students to always speak the truth, abide by dharma. This is what is required. We must go back to our roots. Our education system must really be based on ethics, values of Indian civilization. Our children must be taught about the history, the great sacrifice made by great people, the social reformers, or the freedom fighters. Children should be taught and they should be made to know about the great sacrifice made by all these people across the country. This is very much required. Many people, many youngsters do not know about Veerapandiya Kattabomman, V.O. Chidambaram Pillai, Subramanya Bharati, or Muthu Ramalinga Thevar, Pasumpan Muthu Ramalinga Thevar, all these great sons, they have done great things in their life. What for? Not for themselves, for the sake of our future, freedom. So we should have history, culture, values, traditions, morals, ethics as part of our education system. Discipline makes people to shine in their lives. So I advise all the youngsters, whatever you may do, discipline. Second is hard work. Work hard. Aim high. Dream high. Then you will reach high. Simply aiming and simply dreaming without working, without discipline, you cannot reach heights. Dr. Kalam has said, aim high, dream high, work hard. So youngsters, we should work hard. Your parents are sending you to these institutes by spending good amount of money because they want a good future for you. So you must understand the sacrifices that the parents are making, the society is expecting from you, and we must be disciplined, we must be hardworking. And in this country, one beautiful thing about this country is if you work hard, irrespective of your background, you can reach heights. Dr. Kalam studied in an ordinary school, no political background. Sri Narendra Bhai Modi, Prime Minister, studied in an ordinary school, not even seen the convent also. Became the Prime Minister, powerful Prime Minister of this country. The President, Sri Ramnath Kovind, he also gone to village school. Even I, son of a farmer, I studied in a street school, village school, never went to convent, but still could reach this position. That is the beauty of our Indian system. So keeping that in mind, I advise all the children to work hard, aim high, be disciplined, and then you will definitely reach heights. This is my advice to all of you. As you are all aware, education enables people to break the shackles of poverty. Around Coimbatore, Tirupur, Namakkal, Polachi, say that many of these places, poverty is comparatively less. The reason being because educationally we are moving forward. Education takes care of poverty, more than anything else. An education system that upholds Indian values, virtues of civilization, and inculcates a sense of oneness and compassion in the minds of the youngsters is the need of the hour. At the same time, it should equip the students to face modern day challenges by imparting the requisite knowledge and skills. My dear students, 72 years after independence, we are yet to achieve 100% literacy rate. It's a challenge before us. 20% are illiterate even today. Around 20% are below poverty line. You still have some social challenges here and there. Discrimination on the basis of caste. You have some challenges, discrimination on the basis of gender. These are the challenges the youth of the country must be progressive, must try to address along with the people in power. There has to be concerted effort from both the government and the private sector to ensure accessibility of quality education affordable rates to students, particularly from the downtrodden and marginalized sections of the society. The private education institutions must supplement the government's efforts in making India a 100% literate country. It empowers people to overcome the challenges such as poverty, hunger, and helps in promoting inclusive and equitable economic growth. Education alone has the power to bring in a change in lifestyles and empower the people. In a way, education is the key to the sustainable development of a human being or a nation. My dear youngsters, India is on the cusp of a major transformation. Reforms undertaken by the government and the progress being registered by several state governments are making India the fastest growing large economy in the world. The Prime Minister has given a 3-line advice. He said, reform, perform, and transform. Transformation of the nation is the need of the hour. And this transformation is possible if there is a public-private partnership, if there is a people's involvement in all the movements, be it Swachh Bharat, Green India, Make in India, Digital India, for drop, more crop, or with regard to plastic, with regard to driving away the social evils, and also preserving, regenerating our rivers. Oh, Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, all these things should become a people's movement. They should not be confined to governmental programs alone. This has to be understood by all. And moreover, we are a democracy. We are an independent country. We are no more under foreign rule. They ruled us, ruined us, rooted us, cheated our minds also. We must come out of that colonial mindset, develop self-respect, develop self-confidence, and then take advantage of the demographic dividend. 65% of the Indian population are below 35 years. 50% of the population are below 25 years. We have the greatest advantage, and also we have the greatest skills in India also. Lot of skills are available among the ordinary people. It's not confined to only few people, but the skills has to be recognized. They have to be encouraged. That is duty of the government and as well as private sector and well-meaning people. The 21st century technology dependent market scenario is there. So you must align educational policies, curricula and training programs in that context. The education system must integrate skilling to maximum the benefits of globalization. It is time that education institutions focus more on the assimilation of diverse information, problem solving, decision making and analysis, and shun rote methods, promoting research in a big way, establishing linkages with industry to give exposure to students passing out of these institutions must be paid adequate attention. I call upon all the education institutions and teachers to provide their valuable inputs to government on the new education policy. The policy should highlight aspects such as Indian history, culture, values and ethos. My dear students, India was once known as Vishwaguru, world knowledge leader. We must strive to achieve that status once again. You have that ability. We have the abilities. There is no dearth of skills among the people. Every daddy tapper, weaver, goldsmith, fisherman, washerman, baba, cook, everybody has got some skill or other. What is required is identify the skill. Upgrade the skill. I'm happy that happens in Coimbatore. It happens in Tirupur. It happens in Namakkal and the surrounding areas. It should become a people's movement, recognizing the skill and encouraging the skill. To take out the hidden talent, many of our Indians are heading the leading organizations in the world. I was just going through a news item. Google CEO, Indian. Microsoft CEO, Indian. Citigroup CEO was an Indian. SoftBank Vision Fund CEO is an Indian. Adobe CEO is an Indian. NetApp CEO is an Indian. PepsiCo CEO is an Indian. Nokia CEO is an Indian. MasterCard CEO is an Indian. DBS CEO is an Indian. Cognizant CEO is an Indian. Novartis CEO is an Indian. Conduent CEO is an Indian. Diageo CEO is an Indian. SanDisk CEO Indian. Motorola CEO is an Indian. Harman CEO Indian. Micron CEO Indian. Recfit, Banxair CEO is an Indian. IBM CEO is an Indian. International Monetary Fund Chief Economic Advisor, Chief Economic Advisor of the International Monetary Fund is an Indian. And a South Indian from Mysore. Gita Gopin Reddy. I have a big list. I don't want to take your time. What does it mean? So there is knowledge. There is talent. You need to recognize and encourage it. That should be done by the government, should be done by the education institutions. Education in arts and humanities shape the thinking of the youth and enable them to build the livable, equitable societies. Arts and humanities. I also urge education institutions to promote the spirit of volunteerism and community service among the students. You must also develop that habit of social service. One need not enter politics to do service. You can do service at your own level. I have no objection. Youth, if they want to join politics, yes, yesterday I was there in Delhi addressing a chhatra or sansad. I said, okay, youth should join politics in large number because they have the zeal. This party or that party is your choice. But first try to know the politics. Understand. And also know about parliament, legislature. Read the debates in parliament. Read the constitutional assembly debates. Read about the freedom movement. Read about the social transformation brought in by great people. Read Thirukkural, Bhagavad Gita. Read a lot of other spiritual books, whatever is of interest to you. Go through the life of Adi Shankara. Go through the life of Basaveswara. Go through the life of many of the reformers like that. You will get light for the future. And you will become bright. And you will reach the height in future. You have to understand this. So you have to read and learn. You must shun negativism. Please shun negativism. Unfortunately, negativism here and there is seen and encouraged by some people. We are not ruled by foreigners. We are our own country. You elect your corporator, your sarpanch, your municipal chairman, your mayor, your chief minister, your prime minister. You have that power. Every 5 years you can change without any violence. By silence you can press the button and then issue is decided. That is the beauty. And we are the largest parliamentary democracy in the world. So keeping that in mind, we should leave negativism, add positivism. We should leave obstruction, destruction, go for construction. That is what is required for the national reconstruction. Try to understand, this is very important. Politics, education, health, medical, the other things, are journalism are all considered once upon a time as a mission. Mission. Of late, some people started taking commission, giving remission, doing omission, forgetting the mission, leaving the passion. How you got this opportunity in Coimbatore, so many education institutions? And this many institutions by the PSG group, because they took education as a mission. And they started expanding it, reaching out to a lot of people. That passion has to be there. And anybody joining public service, including politics, must have that ambition. Not only to become leader, but to serve the people. We need to develop leadership qualities. Leadership, not dealership. That is for the business. Leadership, nothing wrong. But that's a business. But leadership. Who is a leader? A leader who knows the people. A leader who knows the subject. A leader who has got character, caliber, capacity and conduct. A leader who works for others. A leader who thinks about the society. A leader who thinks nation first, party next, self last. That should be the quality of a leader. So, try to become a leader, and then, as I told you, shun negativism, and adopt a constructive approach to the life, and ensure that nobody indulge in violence. violence is not acceptable in democracy. That's the enemy of the people. Anybody who is encouraging violence are doing at the cost of the nation. The forces of violence should never be encouraged. Nothing wrong in a democracy. You want to demonstrate, demonstrate. You want to protest, protest. You want to speak against the government, speak. You want to speak against the injustice, speak. But allow others also to speak. And some people nowadays complain, sir, we are becoming intolerant. I told him, first of all, you are becoming intolerant because you don't want to tolerate the views of the other person. Your people should hear your view only. Otherwise, he is intolerant. How can he? And one must be tolerant towards the mandate of the people. People are given a mandate. No, respect it. And protest if you want. Dissent. There's also a discussion, some youngsters here and there, there's no scope for dissent. India. How can anybody say that there's no? Dissent is an essential quality of democracy. Dissent is welcome, but not disintegration. You can't speak against the nation. You can't speak against the country. You can't speak about our own unity and integrity. We may be different languages. We may wear different dress. But as I always say, alag bhasha, alag vesh, phir bhi apna ek desh. Vividhata mein ekata, Bharat ka visheshata. Irrespective of caste, creed, sex, religion and region, India is one, one nation, one people, one country. Feel proud? Feel proud that you are a Tamilian, or a Telugu, or a Marathi or Punjabi, but feel proud that you are an Indian first, Indian first. So you must have that feeling. Anything happening in Kashmir should be a matter of concern to Kanyakumari and Coimbatore. Anything happening here in Kerala or Coimbatore or Kanyakumari should be a matter of concern for Arunachal, Himachal, Uttaranchal. That is the national spirit. Then only the country can progress and can be strong. As we have already experienced because of disunity, we lost freedom. And it took years to get back our freedom. So we should not allow dissensions. Dissent, as I told you, is an essence of democracy, but it should be peaceful. And we must wait. You should not become impatient. If you become too much impatient, you will become impatient. And then become a real patient. And then you know what will happen. So be patient. And do your duty. The remaining things will be taken care by the system. This is my advice to all of you. That's why, as I see a violence here and there preached by some people, and also incidents happening here and there, one good thing is out of 936 universities, only 5 or 6 universities are news for wrong reasons. All others, like you are all focusing on your education, your study, and your future, and country and society, I am very happy about you. As the Vice President of India, I see the youngsters focusing their attention, making marks, getting grades for their institutions. I feel happy and reassured about the future of our nation. And I see all of you youngsters, the boys and girls. Yesterday I was there in Delhi. There was a program. Today is the International Mother Languages Day. Because of Sivaratri, today Mahasivaratri, we celebrated it in Delhi yesterday. Because otherwise everybody is called to Delhi on a Sivaratri day. Difficult. So we have organized Government of India, HRD Ministry and also Culture Ministry together. And UNESCO also has given a call. The Matru Bhasha Divas or Mother Tongue Day should not be confined to one day. It has to be an everyday issue. So that's why wherever I go, I tell 4 things. One, remember mother. Mother who has given you the beautiful birth. Mother includes father also. Woman, man is there and woman, na? So both are taken care. Second, Janma Bhumi, the native place, wherever you go up, do not forget your native place, do something for that. Third is the Matru Bhasha, the mother tongue, beautiful language that has come from mother's womb. You must always promote, propagate, feel proud of your mother tongue, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayali, Marathi, Assami, Punjabi, Bhojpuri, Dogri, Urdu, whatever it is. feel proud of your mother tongue. At home, speak in mother tongue only. At home, with your neighbors, speak in mother tongue only. Why should you use other language, foreign language at home also? And unfortunately, the weakness because of the colonial rule and education system, the parents also, they tell the children, Babu, say, Mummy, Daddy. And you have beautiful Amma, Ma. Why should you say Mummy? Why should you say Mummy? Ma, it comes from heart. Mummy comes from the lips. Try once in the evening in the hostel. You will understand. I am not against any language, foreign language also. Learn as many languages as possible, but don't forget your mother tongue. That's why I say mother tongue is like your eyesight. Another language is like your spectacles. If you have eyesight, spectacles will work. If you have no eyesight, then there won't be any sight, forget the foresight. Even if you wear reborn glasses, Juban se kuch aayega nahi. My dear youngsters, please promote your mother tongue, speak in your mother tongue. And then learn as many languages as possible. The education system of the country also must really undergo a change where the primary education, secondary education up to secondary level at least must be in the mother tongue to start with. Then, because bhasha aur bhavana ek saath chalta hai. The children, they will be able to understand, articulate better in their mother tongue. I was just reading Sardar Vallabhai Patel's life yesterday. He said in 1946, while addressing Nagpur University, he said that forcing the children and putting them in English medium in the school, first of all, the children should know the subject now. Most of the energy is spent on knowing the language rather than subject. There is a difference, no? Language and subject. First know the language and then you know the subject. That's what is big. No. To understand the subject easily, you must first of all promote education in primary and secondary in mother tongue. So that the children, because naturally, Amma Bhasha, Amma Matru Garbhavani Chuchana Matru Bhashani, Marchipovadam Manava Lakshanam Kane Kaadu Ane Vishayana Kuda Vanandaram Gurtupettukovali. And also, let there be constructive debate in the schools, colleges, among students on national and international issues. Always remember, violence and hatred have no place in a democracy. Dialogue, debate are the best available forms to resolve any conflict, dispute or disagreement. That's why I tell my parliamentarians also, I am also chairman of the upper house, Rajya Sabha. So I tell my MPs, people, children are watching. In the recent past, one member, he became a little angry with me. He said, oh, do you think that we're all the school children? Primary school children, he said. I thought myself, dealing with the school children is better. Because they're receptive and they're disciplined. Parliamentarians also must remember the great standards maintained by those great parliamentarians. And raise the standard so that we can inspire others. Inspire others. That's why I tell them, you want to talk out, talk out. You want to walk out, walk out. But don't do break out. Otherwise it will lead to all out. In democracy. All out of the system. And what is the best way? 3D. Discuss, debate, decide. Not the fourth D. That is disrupt. No. And I tell them also, the people say, oh sir, this is, whatever it is, discuss. You discussed Article 370, you discussed the Tribul Talaq, you discussed the Citizenship Amendment Bill, you want to discuss something more, discuss and decide. What is the way in democracy? Let the government propose, let the opposition oppose, let the house dispose. That is the only way, house. That's how these things have come. So please read the great debates. And I also want the children to read what is a citizenship amendment. Citizenship amendment has nothing to do with Indian citizens. Many people do not know that. It is only for the people who are persecuted in the neighboring countries. That is the bill. Many people do not even read that. Read, analyze, and then act or react. That's your choice. I am not there to advise you. 370, Article Kashmir. Was a temporary provision. Temporary. 72 years. Now the parliament have discussed it, debated it. After thorough debate, abrogated it. Because it's temporary. Temporary. Some people are trying to create a wrong impression about India, and our neighbor is aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorism. They always try to rake up that issue. It's a settled issue. Kashmir is an integral part of India, not even an inch of Kashmir. Our neighbor will ever get it. He should know that. And we will not allow any outside interference. Now it has become fashion nowadays, my dear youngsters. Some countries to make comment about our India internal affairs. Babu, you manage your affairs. We are capable of managing our affairs. We are capable of managing our affairs. Don't get into our and give advice from there. All. So even some of the Western countries, they always try to, they say they will discuss this Kashmir, they want to discuss the CAA and all. I told them in one of the days in Parliament, because I also have the responsibility of chairman of the Rajya Sabha, I said, if Indian Parliament start discussing Brexit and exit, what will be your reaction? We don't do it. We will discuss our issues. And we are capable of deciding also our issues. Same is the case with our legislative assemblies also. So that is the best way forward, and all these citizens of the country must respect democratic values and then try to strengthen it. As I told you, my dear youngsters, remember these two things. One, mother tongue, Mother India. Second, promote, practice a healthy life, avoid sedentary life, eat good food, whatever you like, vegetarian or non-vegetarian or both also, no problem. Third, love and live with the nature. Because nature, culture, together for better future, that is the need of the hour. Nature and culture together for better future. If you take care of nature will take care of you. If you neglect the nature will show its fury. You are seeing how we have mishandled the forestry, the greenery, how we have ruined our rivers. Now we are trying to regenerate the rivers again. Sun, we have such a beautiful weather in India. Sometime back I was travelling in London. My car and driver told me, sir, good morning. I said, namaste. He said, sir, today is a sunny day. I said, is it your son's birthday today? No, sir, sunny day, sunny. I understood. I told him, poor fellow, in India 365 days are sunny days. We have bright sun every day. But off late we are trying to understand the importance of spending some time under the sun. And also we are going for solar. Lot of progress can be made if you are friendly with the nature. This is my another advice to all of you. And also, my dear youngsters, finally, while you are in studies, take care of your physical fitness. Do something and develop and imbibe the culture of share and care. And then remember your alma mater all the time, wherever you are in future, in a big position also, and continue to do something in your life. The line that was shown by this great PSG and Sons, trust what they are doing. I am very happy, as I told you in the beginning, when I received an invitation from Gopalakrishnanji, I told my staff, we have visited earlier, we will visit again also, because visiting Coimbatore, getting more energy, visiting educational institutions, getting regenerated. This is how I feel. I'm very happy. Thank you all. Nandri, Vanakkam.